Welcome to the second episode in our Demystifying the Millennial Kingdom series. In our first episode, we provided a definition of the Millennial Kingdom. We also covered the two main popular views on this subject. And we examined several Bible passages where the evidence certainly points to there being a future earthly reign of Jesus. In part two, we're going to address the timeline of this Millennial Kingdom. Our first Bible passage comes to us from Matthew chapter 25. Here, we see the Messiah will reign right after he returns. The beginning of his earthly reign is also the beginning of the Millennial Kingdom. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 31, we read the following. When the Son of Man comes and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. So, in that short Bible verse, we learned a couple of things. Number one, there's going to come a time when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him. You see, this passage is addressing Jesus' second coming. That event is a yet future event. The scriptures say, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. So it appears that Jesus returns and then he takes his throne. Have you ever been to Jerusalem before? As is well known, there's no Davidic throne there at the moment. There's no temple at the moment. Of course, the throne being referenced here is the Davidic throne, which is supposed to be in Jerusalem. And that'll be an aspect that we'll address in a future episode. Another Bible passage that teaches that the Messiah must reign after he returns is Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 through 8. In Revelation 19, John is given a vision. In this vision, there's a celebration going on in heaven. The marriage of the Lamb has been announced. And in verse 6, he writes the following. Then I heard something like the sound of a vast multitude, like the sound of cascading waters, and like the rumbling of loud thunder saying, Hallelujah, because our Lord, the Almighty, has begun to reign. Let us be glad, rejoice, and give him glory, because the marriage of the Lamb has come. And his wife has prepared herself. She was given fine linen to wear, bright and pure, for the fine linen represents the righteous acts of the saints. Now, our point here is this. It is at a time yet in the future that this vision becomes a reality. John writes, Hallelujah, because the Lord has begun to reign. In other words, there's a time coming when Jesus will actually begin his reign on earth. Does Jesus have the right to reign right now? Absolutely. Indeed, God is currently reigning over all creation, over the entire universe. God's reigning over everything. God is sovereign over everything. But we have to be careful here and not confuse the messianic reign in the kingdom with God's present universal reign. God's universal kingdom is his heavenly rule. It's always in existence. God's reign is eternal. It's comprehensive. It's unlimited. It's absolute. The planets are upheld by God's sovereign reign. The sun and the moon are shining today because of God's universal reign and sovereignty. God's universal kingdom and his reign are limitless and vast and certainly encompasses more than the earth. But God's messianic kingdom is unique from his universal kingdom. So we must be careful not to confuse the two. The messianic kingdom is yet future, located on earth. It's temporal. It has a beginning and an end. God's universal reign is unending. He's always reigned and he always will reign. The question before us today is, when does Jesus' reign actually begin on earth? Based on the passages covered so far, it appears his reign begins after he returns. And if that's the case, we cannot be living in the Millennial Kingdom right now. Which again, that's the position of amillennialism. The amillennial position proposes that we're in the kingdom right now. This is despite wars, pandemics, terror attacks, extreme poverty, starvation. Despite there not being a temple in Jerusalem as described in Ezekiel 40 to 48. Amillennialism is a position that unintentionally gaslights Bible readers. We read one thing in the Bible, and then someone comes along and says, "Well, I know you read that, but here's what it's actually saying. Israel doesn't mean Israel. These descriptions of a future time of peace where the Messiah is reigning in Jerusalem aren't literal. It's just ways that the prophets speak. There's no future kingdom coming. We're living in it right now." Now, there are many wonderful, godly people who hold to this position. There are many who hold to amillennialism because they've never heard a different position explained to them. And there are many who would describe themselves as amillennial who have a great heart and even a burden for the Jewish people. As we'll see in the coming episodes, there are simply too many descriptions of a future millennial kingdom that do not fit the world as we see it today. One final passage that discusses the timing of the millennial kingdom is Isaiah chapter 2. Starting in verse 1, it says this: "The vision that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem." Let's pause just a second. What we're about to read here is concerning Judah and Jerusalem. That's the nation of Israel. That's the full extent of the Jewish people in the land. Isaiah writes this: "In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house will be established at the top of the mountains and will be raised above the hills. All nations will stream to it, and many peoples will come and say, 'Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us about his ways so that we may walk in his paths.' For instruction will go out of Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will settle disputes among the nations and provide arbitration for many peoples. They will turn their swords into plows and their spears into pruning knives. Nations will not take up the sword against other nations, and they will never again train for war." Now, clearly, we're not living in a period that fits this description. We've recently been through two world wars. There are conflicts going on all over the globe at the time of this recording. And yet Isaiah says there's going to come a time when people will turn their swords into plowshares. In other words, there's no use for war anymore. Instead, turn these weapons of war into tools for agriculture. We're simply not there yet, but that day is coming. Now, from these passages, we were able to get a better sense of when the millennial kingdom will take place. Namely, it's a time that's after the Lord's return, and yet before eternity future. Therefore, that puts the millennial kingdom between the Lord's return and when he establishes eternity future. The millennial kingdom, as we'll see in future episodes, will be 1,000 years in length. Are you aware of all the different kinds of teachings that we have on our recently launched YouTube channel? The content of these videos range from Bible teachings to interviews with people on the streets of Jerusalem. If you haven't done so yet, hit those like and subscribe buttons so that you're notified of all future videos. Thanks so much for joining us today as we continue to demystify the millennial kingdom. Until next time, Shalom.